Hi guys, and welcome to our Scrapy Selenium tutorial. In this tutorial, we'll be bringing you through how to render and scrape JavaScript websites. So the different steps we're going to look at is first installing Scrapy Selenium, then how to integrate Scrapy Selenium with our Scrapy Spider, and then how to actually interact with the page using Scrapy Selenium. Okay, so let's get started. So the first thing we want to do is get our Scrapy project set up. So for this, we have a project that you can clone directly from GitHub and use as part of this tutorial. So we have the link to that in the description of this video, so you can just git clone it. So we'll just do that now. Git clone, it downloads the project for us. And then the next thing we want is we want to set up our Python virtual environment. So I'll quickly do that. So we'll do that with python-mvenv, and we'll now call the folder venv. Again, all these commands will be in the article which accompanies this video. The link to this article will also be in the description. The next thing we want to do is activate our environment. So we can do that with this simple command here. And now we want to install Scrapy, obviously, because that's the scraping framework we're using. And then after that, we want to install the Scrapy Selenium framework. Now, we could integrate Selenium directly into our Scrapy project, but it's much easier to use this pre-built Scrapy Selenium project. Okay, that's all installed. So now that we have that, the next thing to do is to install Chromedriver. Chromedriver is basically what Scrapy is going to be using to interact with and create headless browser instances of Chrome. So we need to download Chromedriver, so we can do that from the official Chromedriver website. So the only thing to watch out for here is to make sure that the version of Chromedriver that you're downloading matches the version of Chrome that you have if you're using Chrome. So here I can see in the settings for Chrome, I'm currently on version 105. And if I go to Chrome WebDriver, I want to download this version 105 here. So this is the version I'm going to download. I've already got that downloaded, so I don't need to download it again. But you guys just go ahead and download that now if you don't already have it. Okay, so once you have Chromedriver downloaded, you want to add it into the project at the same level as the readme file and the scrapy.cfg file are at. So once it's there, we can now add in the correct settings that we need to make sure that it can run correctly. So we're going to go to our settings.py file, which is inside the project we downloaded, settings.py there. And let's just add in the Selenium driver settings. I've just copied and pasted them directly from the article. You guys can do the same. If you have Witch working correctly on your machine, you can use the Witch and Chrome driver here. Myself, I'm going to add the full path in, as I know this works correctly. So that's the full path to where Chrome driver is here for me. So again, that'll be different on your own machine, but that's the easiest way to get that working. We're going to be running the browser in headless mode so that it's not actually, you know, launching a new browser every time that we can see. You can remove that, and if you do want to actually see it clicking through different pages, that's an option. And that's basically all we need. If you want Selenium to run Firefox, then you're going to have a slightly different set of arguments here, but those are also in the accompanying article. So that's up to you. For this, we're just going to use Chrome. So now we can continue on. Let's go to our spider and let's add the code in to get our spider working correctly. So our spider is going to be scraping this quotes to scrape.com JS site, which if you've been following any of our other videos, is this very handy site that is used for learning how to scrape different types of websites. So this is a JavaScript rendered website. If we check the network tab, we can actually see the different, if we refresh the page, we can see that the quotes are not showing in the preview that comes back from the response, because if we look at the response, all the data is in a JavaScript array, and then that gets populated in by the browser when it actually arrives to the browser. So if you were to just use conventional scraping techniques, you wouldn't be able to get all the quotes that are actually on screen, because all that your conventional scraping technique would be able to scrape is this small bit of text here. So that's why we need to use something like Scrapy Selenium or Scrapy Splash or Scrapy Playwright, which first renders the page for us and then lets us actually use our spider to scrape the correctly rendered data. Okay, we can now try and run this using, if we're in the correct folder, using the scrapy command. So let's just do a scrapy list first. Okay, that's saying that scrapy selenium is not found. We just need to deactivate our virtual environment and reactivate it first. So just the deactivate command, and then we can just go back up the folder to where our virtual environment is, reactivate it, and then let's try that scrapy list again. There you go. And now let's do a scrapy crawl quotes, and we're going to put the output into results.json just to make it that bit easier to read the results. And perfect. So as you can see, here is the results.json file that was created, and here are all the quotes from the page that we were just looking at. The thing we're going to look at now is how to add a standard wait time, just to wait for the page to load before we try rendering it, because sometimes if we try and render the page straight away, then it might not have actually fully loaded in and we might only get half of the results that we're looking for. So it is important that we learn how to use waits correctly. We can also wait for a page element to actually display on the page before we move on to the next step. And that's something as well that we're going to look at now. Okay, so let's go back to our spider and let's modify our spider to add in a simple wait time. So that's just passing into this Selenium request, just passing in one more argument, wait time, and this is 10 seconds. You can modify that, play around with it. Obviously, that can impact the amount of time your spider takes to scrape a large website. So that's something you need to be aware of and play around with to find the optimal wait time for you. So let's just quickly try and run that now and see, do the results come back just as we expect them to? Let's just run that using the same scrapy crawl quotes command and see what the result is. So item scraped count is 10, perfect. And if we open results file, we have the results that we were looking for. That results file is being overwritten every time as well, just in case you're wondering why we don't have 20 results this time. Okay, so we're now going to look at adding in a wait for element with the scrapy request. So we're going to be replacing this Selenium request with a slightly modified version where we have this wait until argument being passed in. We're going to be importing two more features here. So we're going to wait until the quotes element is on screen. So again, this is the quote class, which we can see if we go to one of our quotes, inspect the element, and we can see there's the quote class that we're waiting for. So now that we have that, let's just again try and run that and see, does it work correctly? And we have item scrape count of 10. So that did work correctly. And the results file is not empty. It's got the results we wanted. So it waited until the quote was on screen and then returned the page. Now, one thing to note is that if the quote is not shown within 10 seconds, then it throws an error. So these two options are linked together. If you only do a wait time of 1 second, then obviously if it doesn't find quotes within 1 second, it'll also throw an error. So we're going to just leave that at 10 seconds for now. Okay, so the next thing we're going to look at is how to click on a button using a JavaScript snippet of code. So this can be useful in lots of different things that you might want to do with a page, not just clicking on a button. It could be scrolling, it could be changing colors of text, replacing text. There's lots of different manipulations you might want to do on the page using JavaScript. So we're going to show you now how you can quickly do that. So it's actually quite simple. All we're doing is adding again one more argument into the arguments of the Selenium request. So instead of the wait time and wait until, we're just going to replace that with script. And what we're going to be saying is document.querySelector, and then we're going to have a CSS selector in here, and then we're just going to say .click on that CSS selector. So let's save that and try and run that and see what happens. I'll just go through first what should happen is it will be going to the page, finding the next button, and then with JavaScript it'll be doing a click event on the next button and loading the next page. So again, we should see 10 results returned, except we should see it should be 10 different quotes that are on the page. So this long Marilyn Monroe quote should be the first one that gets returned to us. So I'm just going to run that. If we check the results, go up to the top, it's a long quote by Marilyn Monroe. Perfect. So it worked correctly, and we can see item script count of 10 is there as well. So obviously you can add in whatever JavaScript you want in here. This is just what I picked for this example. And the other handy thing with JavaScript snippets as well, you can usually test out the results of the snippet by just going to your console, pasting in the snippet, and then the page will actually respond to that JavaScript snippet. So as we can see there, it's bringing us to the next page each time. So we could, for example, click on the login button, click on the header to go back to the main page, whatever you find that you can do within the console should work when you put it into the script argument here. Now, the only thing I would say is that Selenium can be a little bit finicky with this stuff, so it doesn't always 100% work if it works in the console. There might be issues with the page not loading in time or things like that, so it's not the most reliable of things to use out there in terms of frameworks for JavaScript rendering. The last thing I wanted to show you guys in this video is how to take a screenshot using Scrapy Selenium. So again, it's just replacing one more argument here. So instead we're going to have screenshot equals true, and we're going to just replace our parse function, because this time we want to write an image to the output. So I already have one here. I'm just going to delete that one that I have, and then I'm going to again run the spider. So I'll just take a second or two, and as you can see, an image was created, and here we have our image. So it's very easy to use Selenium requests with just passing in the different argument based on if you want a bit of JavaScript to be running, you want a screenshot to be taken, etc., etc. And then whatever is returned will be processed by this parse function as usual with Scrapy. So that's the end of this tutorial, guys. If you have any questions or comments, or you get stuck on any part of this tutorial, just leave us a comment in the description below and we'll get back to you. And we also have other videos on other frameworks you can use to process JavaScript rendered websites. So we also go through Scrapy Splash and Scrapy Playwright. So be sure to check those out as well if you guys are just checking out what Scrapy can do. Thanks, guys, and see you in the next video.